people who love libraries, we're book nerds, and you don't get to be a book nerd without doing your homework. And I did my homework.
So I have a couple questions about Philip Roth and his influence on you. That's that you mentioned him in the acknowledgments page of the book.
Go ahead.
Do you have the picture?
I have a picture because when I took this class,
picture is so to me that I think that picture is, I really thought that was the best picture I've seen of Philip Roth, but I think maybe it was the story. The story and the promotional materials that explained the picture. But
I was in this class. It was a year long seminar. Only 15 kids were in it. And of course, every week we read a different book, and he would assign it. And he shows him lecturing. He never did anything but lecture. He sat there completely composed. He never got up. He never talked with his hands. He never really addressed us. This is all fine. I'm not complaining. I'm just going, I wanted to set the scene for you a little. And so it was like taking physics from Einstein, because basically what he did was sort of take a novel. You read the novel, you go in and you go, now here's what makes this novel great. Classics. Here's what makes this novel a classic. Madame Flaubert, anyone, Robert Musil, I could go on. And reduce it. Take a look at this chapter. Now let's look at this paragraph. Now let's look at the sentence. Now let's look at this verb. Right from the macro to the micro, take it down. And that's all he did. And that's everything he did. And I think it was an unbelievable education. And it was a year-long course.
Yeah. So
imagine, that many weeks of just read a great novel and listen to someone explain to you what makes a great novel.
Did it change the way did it change the way you thought when you read novels after that?
Yes. And it changed the way I read. It educated me. Let's hear it for teachers. I mean, to me, what's so amazing, the takeaway for me is that teachers are so amazing. I am a product of public education and public libraries. And I've always felt teachers have an enormous impact. Sadly, they've passed, but after my first books was out 30 years ago, I would go to lunch with my high school English teachers, Miss Cobb and Miss Haas, and they would tear me apart. And they were harder than the New York Times. It was amazing. But teachers mean so much to me, and I think we all acknowledge the effect they have. But here's a teacher. Okay, he happens to be a little famous guy, but that doesn't really matter. In my context, he was a teacher. And 40 years later, had such an effect on me that I thought about what he taught me for 40 years.
Yeah. I've
used it every day in my job, and finally said, that guy whose books you introduced me to, watch this.
Another question about Roth. What's your favorite Philip Roth novel? And what is his writing? Oh, there's a cat or a dog or
there's
something.
A dog. There's five dogs.
What is his writing? Like what? I wanted to ask what from his writing worked its way into Eternal, but it sounds like that's not what worked its way in. What worked its way in is the way you think about books.
Right. Because
are you a fan of him as a writer? I'm just curious. I mean,
yes. Yeah. I mean, I think, sure. But the thing about Eternal is, and this was a hard part for me, because what he taught me was voice. Like you have to write with an authentic voice. Now you're not writing about yourself, so you have to write in a character's voice. Now those characters may be some aspect of yourself for an emotional truth. So when you take a book like Portnoy's Complaint, which is controversial, but one of his biggest books certainly, that's a very voicey book. It's written in this young man's voice who's free of his mother and loves his mother, but also angry of his mother. And authenticity matters, truth matters. So that's the lesson that I take from Roth. So when I write Eternal, interestingly, for the first time, I can't write in a contemporary voice. Every single one of my novels is in a contemporary voice. Well, I talk like this. I'm from South Philly. I live outside of Philadelphia. My characters have to vary their voices in a contemporary novel. But this one I had to change. There's no contractions, so that it all had to be of a piece. And I'm such a control freak that I was like, I love my publisher. I was like, okay, guys, I want to see this cover. And I wanted to hear that. I wanted to feel like paper. I want to see the font. I want the font to look a little archaic.
And it does too.
I know, they're great. I said, everything, when you and when you read the period fiction of the time, like Elsa Morante, you know, they have expressions. I've used this before, but they say, instead of gossip, they say people talk behind their hands. And I kind of love that expression. It's a visual. And also Italians do a lot of gesturing, as you know, instead of words. So, you know, it's quiet or I don't care, or you know what that means. So my point is that all of that had to be authentic. In the same way you couldn't have a Corvette drive through, you can't have her say something like, I know, right? Yeah. Because that's how people talk now, right? You can't do that. So that was a really tough one for me but then I said, well, just find Elisabetta's truth and be her. And that made it, and that was the challenge, but it was also great, great, great fun.
And one more question about Roth. I'll keep hammering Roth forever, I guess. But so question is, did you ever imagine when you were writing Eternal, did you imagine the book as the subject of Roth's seminar on literature of the Holocaust? What do you think he would have said about that? Oh, you did. That's great. I thought you might. What do you think he would have said about it?
I think, well, first off, Lynn, I just say, because I have to brag that I got an A from Philip Roth both semesters. Both semesters, baby.
That's awesome.
And of course, like, I can't even find those papers anymore because you know how you
are. He probably didn't give many A's either. He's a serious guy.
He was a very serious guy. I mean, he had us call him Mr. Roth, which I'm fine with that.
Pretty serious, yeah.
No one did that then. It was like the 70s. They were like, call me Ellen, you know. I don't think he knew any of our names. He never tried. It wasn't about, there were no office hours. I understand. I did ask his permission to take that picture. I said, listen, I'm on the yearbook staff, you know, can I do this? Because you are like legit professor. And he's like, yes. He was very formal. The only word I ever said to him was there was a class party that somebody had. It was a friend of his who invited us. So then I was right next to him at one point. And I was like, what are you going to say? And then these people had a cat. So the cat, walk by, and I said something like, that's a nice cat. Do you like cats? And he's like, yes, I like cats. And you're like, this is your chance to talk to one of the greatest, you know, minds in American literature. And you're like, do you like cats? Do you like dogs? That was all I said to Philip Roth.